Hello, my name is Bartek Borczynski, and I represent Nobia. We are a Swedish kitchen company, a group of companies. And like Lourens mentioned, we are in the beginning of our journey. Very early stage. What we wanted to do today is tell you a little bit about ourselves as a business, where we come from in terms of our challenges, and why is it that we've embarked on this journey. And then Lourens will take over and also tell you a little bit about the solution that is being built for us. We do kitchens. We're Europe's leading kitchen specialist. We do a little bit of bathroom. We do a little bit of bedroom. But kitchen is really what we live and breathe. You will not really know us as Nobia unless you're very interested in a Swedish or Stockholm stock market. But we are a number of companies that you might recognize when we go towards our map. Our motto is to make inspiring kitchens easy. To purchase a kitchen takes, as we found out, 268 decisions. And it's not a figure that I made up. We actually made a proper research in the UK with one of our brands. This is the number of decisions that need to be taken when we procure as customers, when we procure a kitchen. And in average, we do it every 10 years. So it's a very big decision for your household. We want to make it as smooth and as easy as possible. And we, from supply chain and from transport perspective, we want to contribute to that. I myself, I'm Nobia's head of transport. I have my colleague Joachim with me, who represents transport procurement, and we've chosen to lead this project on Nobia's end. We're 6,000 people in total, 13 units, net sales of around 1.3 billion euros. Head office in Stockholm, however, no operation in Stockholm. We've got plants across Europe, which I'll show you in a moment. That's where you might recognize us. If you live in one of these geographies, you might recognize these brands. Apart from these brands, which are primarily our own brands, you will know us through the product that we sell as private label to third parties. So if you're from UK, you will know us as Wix or Benchmarks. You will know us also in Finland under our own brand of Keittiö Maailma. You will know us as Mirehöshök in Sweden, Power Expert, and a number of other brands. We sell our kitchens directly to business customers, to construction companies. We've got our own stores. We work with franchisees. We sell our product in a number of different ways. And we operate through a network of local sites, predominantly producing locally and distributing locally. Around 10,000 kitchens we produce every year, 135,000 cabinets. To give you a little bit more feel, we talk about maybe 35 to 40,000 cubic meters of product every single week from all of these sites. Our strategy is to limit the number of sites, to create the sites that are less brand dependent, that produce for different brands across these regions. We are regional, as I've said. Half of us are in the Nordics, almost half in the UK, and a little Austrian island. Austria was less alone in our history. We had some departures from the group. As you can see in our history, we're a fairly young company, started in 1996, grew by acquisitions. And that's an important bit for us because it also drives the complexity and the legacies that put us in a position where we are right now when we launch OTM. We grew quite rapidly for the first 10 years, then we had a bit of a quiet period. And for the last few years, we became active again, selling and buying new companies. So that was that part with the pretty slides from the PR pack. Now we will go on with the slides that I've prepared that are a little bit more nerdy with palettes and shrink foil and that kind of stuff. A little bit about our product, how it looks. So we do predominantly rigid cabinets. But apart from the rigid cabinets, we also do flat pack. We do sliding doors, appliances, worktops, and huge amounts of accessories. So our bill of materials or bill of items in a kitchen is easily more than 100 items. Most of the kitchens are customer ordered, tailor-made. Sometimes we palletize them. Sometimes they're not palletized. But if we do palletize them, then they look roughly like that. And you might know that each of these pallets will have a different name on it. So they already have owners, and they are tailored for this particular customer. Predominantly, we talk about volume, which is high volume, low weight. This is our reality. As far as our geography is concerned, you can see that on that map, this is just an example from the Nordics that we deliver basically to a different address every single day. The next time we show up at this very address will probably be in 10 years, hopefully, if the customer chooses to refurb their kitchen with our product. We sell a lot of extra services. So apart from freight and fuel, we have up to 10 different cost elements, and that goes both for B2C and B2B. We spend around 75 million euros in transportation across the group. Our primary focus is on the outbound. So that's the distribution to the end consumer from the local factory. We do primarily road, full loads, part loads, groupage parcels. Around 10 million we spend on inbound, and that's not our focus really today, but it's going to be tomorrow. As far as systems are concerned, as I've shown you on the picture before, we have a legacy of acquisitions. What that means in the IT environment, that we have quite a portfolio. We've got systems that literally date back to the 80s. We've got systems that only seem to be one system, like PRMS, a prime example that we've got across the Nordics in four different versions. We've got SAP, we've got Oracle, ASW, whatever have you. Quite a complex environment that we work on. Our IT strategy is SAP, but we are also in the beginning of that journey. As far as fleet is concerned, again, quite a portfolio. Depending on the country, sometimes depending on the brand, we can have our own fleet and our own drivers. We can have a third-party operator, but dedicated, or a completely third-party shared user operation. As I mentioned before, primarily road, we do a little ocean, little air, and we are looking into model. As far as contracts are concerned, we predominantly do single sourcing. The reason for that is that we don't look upon transportation as a commodity. We don't run annual or biannual tenders. We want to get very close to the partner. We see transportation, the delivery, as part of our service offering. We tend to repeat that after you've left the showroom with your kitchen designed and this whole process complete, the next Nobia representative or Marbodal representative will be the driver that shows up. So it's very important how this service looks. Also, the kitchens that we sell, these are rather large ticket items. We talk about easily 10,000 euros and over, depending on the brand. And as I mentioned before, these are big purchases, big decisions for a household. Every 10 years, big spend. As far as charging principles, again, we have a full portfolio. We have contract and charging mechanism based on net cube, gross cube, kilos, loading meters, hours, distances, I mean, what have you. Planning, routing, sometimes we do it, sometimes we do it manually, sometimes we do have some systems. Sometimes it's completely outsourced to a third party. Sometimes that third party sits on our site. We've got different processes across the group, even though in the end of the day we produce cabinets, we put them on pallets, and we ship them out. We do this differently for a number of legacy-based reasons. We do limited and sample invoice control. We have limited KPIs. We've got poor visibility, and we could communicate with the customer in a much better way. And I'm quite sure that many of you who are further down on their journey must have had these experiences as well. But that is where we come from, and that is why we've decided to do something about it. We've started this process last year in May, and we've selected a number of partners who will change our world. We've signed with Oracle just before Christmas. We've selected Inspirage to team up for the implementation. One of the big items in Inspirage's portfolio was the ILM app, so the driver app. This is very attractive for us, especially as far as the communication with the customer and the visibility of shipment en route is concerned. We've teamed up also with Unifound. Johan is here today for the carrier connectivity. So instead of establishing integrations with a number of carriers, we integrate with Unifound. Unifound has a platform to communicate with carriers. And we'll use here.com maps. We go in a parallel to stream system. We kicked off very recently, like I told you, end of Jan, 29th of Jan, we kicked off. We are in sixth or seventh week of deployment across Sweden and Finland. So we've got Inspirage teams. Actually today is the fourth day of the first conference room pilot. They are still in Stockholm discussing integrations. We will move in a sequence to other countries after we will have closed deployment in individual countries. I don't feel like I need to sell you the benefits. I took a few highlights out of the presentation that I've put together for our board, where we had to ask for a lot of money. So it was a much thicker one, but we want to really gain control over what we do. We have very limited control. We want to increase our performance, standardize and automate our processes, gain visibility to be able to speak to the customer and communicate where their multi-thousand dollar or euro kitchen is. We want to have a better database to take strategic decisions, both in terms of sourcing ad hoc, but also multiple footprint activities that we're engaging in. And we want to future-proof. We have very, very ambitious growth plans. Until 2020, we want to grow 20%, which is a massive growth. And I can't really imagine ourselves continuing without this. Having said that, I'll hand over to Lourens, who will tell you a little bit about what the guys have built so far for us.
Good. Oh. All right, thank you. I can, you keep it, I'll take this microphone. I thought I'd put up a clock, but anyway, never mind. Good, the solution. So as the challenging part of this project was the fact that we agreed on a short timeline, so starting end of January, February, and with a scheduled go live in June. And there were two flows, two processes that needed to be supported. So both an outbound flow in Sweden and one in Finland. There was also an inbound flow that was known that would be.
Yep. No, I'm just okay. Pointing to you.
Water. those things we had to consider. So we had to decide to make. We couldn't work with one project team because we needed to get all the requirements from the different teams, both in Finland and Sweden. They have different ERPs and the processes are a bit different, different carriers. So it was necessary to have that split up. And so. After that, we synchronized, and of course now with the CRP, this is one CRP, and we have already harmonized the inbound process. That's one. But for outbound, different processes, different systems. So we're still in the middle of how we can try to harmonize that, because that's the that should be the objective, to harmonize where possible. Put some details. The three instances in clouds. So typically, you get two. You always have to get a third. Well, if you want to have a third, some even want three or four or four or five. So a dev, test, and prod. Business requirements workshop separate, as I mentioned, in an outbound and integration design, different ERPs, and also with Unifound. Unifound is also new in the OTM world. So, but that's making good progress on their support for carrier integration, and they were able to fit into the solution and the type of process that we want. So Unifound, in short, is for both booking and label printing, in a nutshell. Good. So I took the liberty to give you a snapshot of what we're doing. And typically in this process, we only have visios where we show what the solution is. And the downside of visios is that you can never read them unless you zoom them in, which I try to do. Right, so I just go over the stuff. I make some notes on the technical solution that we're running into, but a lot of things is pretty straightforward. So this is the inbound, user inbound. You have your order base in OTM. You want to do a you want to release either with the ready to ship or whatever process, and then the planning department can pick it up and do the tendering and whatnot. As you can see, there are two ways of creating the order, both from either from PO or by email. This usually works a bit in it, yeah, so that helps. So we had to make a slight variation between the two processes. Of course, to make a distinction between is it X works or not X works. So that will have a difference in process. However, at the end of the day, we get to the order release. So at the moment, it's envisaged that the supplier will do this. There's already a risk because we know that the releasing process in OTM doesn't have an easy undo button, because when you create an order release, either with ready to ship or with the releasing lines, the counter starts ticking, and the only way to do it is, well, you really have to delete the order release, and typically you don't want your supplier to be able to delete an order release. And there may be some other processes that have kicked up in the meantime. So that is already a thing that we're looking into on how that can be best done. The discussion is, well, some suppliers with high volume, you may trust them, so we gave them proper training, they do so, but for the smaller, just tell me, give me a phone call, and we do it ourselves. So that is the balancing act we're trying to do for that process. Good, so where we end up at the end is the review and approved booking. So I think that what we have here as well. So we're still on the same slide. No magic tricks yet. The inbound, the planner, they have to review all the booking and run the bulk plan and review all the shipments, the calculation, and then there's a normal process, nothing fancy, and that will then go to via Unifound to the process of booking and creating the waybills and whatnot. So there's nothing funny in here. So on the top right, we have the process for the supplier itself. After that's all done and they receive the information, they just have to do all their internal processes to load the truck and packing list and whatnot. And after it's done, we would expect an event for departure, and that's where we go back into to OTM. And at the bottom, for receiving, the same process, a gate in. And update it back into the system. So for inbound, as usual, you want to involve your suppliers, but the support for that and especially the missing undo button is a risk, and we even need to find a balancing there. Okay, the other one, I still have 10 minutes, eh? So we should be good. The other one is outbound. Well, for sake of time, I'm only looking at the Sweden process that we have. Good, let me go back, first time, start. So this is, so we don't have suppliers here, so we can start from OTM speak just with the order release. It isn't as straightforward. We get an order, a transport order, and we book it and we execute. Once we receive the orders, there's a pre-planning process. So we receive the orders, and planner will create shipments, but they will not be executed yet. They want to know what will the shipment look like. You saw all the pallets, and they have to be built, and because they need to inform the carriers. Oh, when you come in 1 or 2 weeks, I will have 3, 4, 5 loading meters for you. So they have to notice in advance. It is an estimate because, of course, after everything is packed and wrapped and it's put into the truck, then you know for sure. So apart from this shipment will not be executed, but only for the purpose of the loading meter calculation. So that we have a question mark. So there are two elements here. It's very difficult in the process for building all the shipments in Nobia to determine, well, this is my kitchen, how will I fit it on a pallet? In theory, you could go to 2.5 meters, but wasn't it one of your directors who received a pallet like that and he didn't like it? So in theory, you can fill it to the truck, but you typically want to be a little bit safer. And there have been several investigations and surveys in Nobia. Okay, how can we automate this? How can we optimize building those pallets with all the cabinets? Some can be put inside. So it's not as easy as you may think. There's a lot of internal knowledge on how to put them how to put this together. There is some rules that have been determined. So based on this kind of order volumes and products, we have a rule where we can calculate the loading meters. This is an estimate, of course, and that is something that we would like to have replicated in OTM. But this is algorithms and formula and nothing to do with 3D. With 3D would not work here. The other. So apart from the fact to determine the loading meter is important, the reason the other part of that question mark is, and that is OTM related. We know we have for shipments, we have weight, we have volume, and possibly loading meters. For this scenario, loading meters are important. First of all, the carrier will select or prepare their shipments based on how much loading meters will be used. The trucks that will pick up the goods will not be dedicated for Nobia. So if they order 4 loading meters and they ship 5, they may say, well, we can't do it because we still need to have the space for another client. So for planning purposes, but also for calculation purposes, they will charge the rates, and that is not uncommon in Europe, rates based on dimensional weight. So 1 kilo equals 300 or 333 kilos, depending on which one is more, had a chargeable weight. But you also have the loading meter weight. So if you are, if you have 1,750 kilos in a loading meter, so if you go over 1,750 kilos, it should be more than 1 loading meter. So there's actually 3 parameters to determine which is the chargeable weight. And OTM doesn't have that functionality. It's based on either weight or volume, the dimensional rating, but not the third element. You can trick by using not volume, but track the volume as being a loading meter and then compare loading meters to weight, but the three of them together doesn't work. One suggestion is if you have simple planning, meaning for one lane you have one carrier, you can pre-calculate the maximum, just having your order, do a little agent and see which is the biggest of the three, and then put that weight into the system and let OTM calculate the cost based on that weight. But then you cannot compare carriers because the rule on loading meters may be 1750, sometimes it's 1500, and the chargeable weight is not always 300 or 333. So if you want to do a optimization between carriers, that trick won't fly. So that's also a balancing act. We don't know what the solution will be, but this is not an uncommon solution. One trick is to say, to go to the carrier, don't ask us to charge a loading meter from salt. But that usually takes more than one day. But it's a long-term plan, and I know other customers have done it as well. Next process in line here, the remaining steps. So I mentioned we started with the pre-planning. So and there is also a pre-booking confirmation in Excel, not in OTM, about what will happen with those, with the confirmation from the carrier about the pre-booking volumes. That's when it will be locked, and then when the real planning starts with order release, the planning, full track, yes or no. Based on that, you're going to do secure resources. So this is all standard process. And then there will be updates from the SAP system after the picking has started and loading ready. So to update or release that in with that information. What we are running into here is you mentioned we're creating the order release very early in the game. It will be updated, and we have more updates. And of course, we want all these changes to be propagated to shipments. That's a separate presentation on its own on how to deal with that. So we may run into issues there as well. On how these propagations will look like, what type of changes we expect. You can start with an order with a number of lines, and if they completely remove all the lines and replace them with new ones, then it will be very difficult to replicate the changes to new shipments. Right. Next one to the bottom element was, I mentioned here, this was the secure resources part. The tender process, either normal just notifications or the tender accept, the usual stuff. So we still need to find a balance on for which one to use what process. The booking process will go through Unifown, so that integration is set up. And of course, this integration will also be used for inbound, as obvious. And final, these are the processes on the actual dispatch itself. So I think that was me. So I guess we'll consolidate all the questions after Bartek has wrapped up.
Sure. Okay. So the last slide from my side is basically our first learnings. Having been on that journey for 6-7 weeks now, we know that we are insanely immature and probably still oblivious to a number of challenges in front of us, and perhaps naive, or all of it. We've experienced first problems with openness to change, even though we had a very wide team of transport managers from across the geography throughout the selection process, and everybody was willing and potentially able. We have some problems as far as changing our processes is concerned. We realize that we probably should have and are doing that now, engaging with management much more and selling the idea of or selling the that rollout much more, because there is so much more people that need to be involved in order for us to be successful in the rollout. On the resources side of things, I think we we have brutally, brutally underestimated the engagement that is needed from both our colleagues at sites as well as us sitting in Stockholm on the IT side of things and on the business side of things. We realized fairly early in the process, and we've succeeded actually in getting an okay for that, to employ a super user very early in the process, someone who from the technical integration of business and IT side of things will be the leader for this project and create this center of excellence, if you will. We have major, major problems with legacy systems. That I would say that's probably the thing that concerns me personally most. Just exiting the ACRP yesterday evening, I'd say that it's legacy systems, and specifically the one that we've got in Finland. Also around that, we have in many cases we have lack of internal competence around these legacy systems, so we need to reach out to consultants. Because some of our systems, as I've said, date back to the 80s. There's not a lot of people alive who can maintain these systems, so it's a bit of a challenge. Another approach that I think we should be taking, and you need to tell me if I'm being stupid, but we tend to get very excited because we go through these processes and we find out, oh, we can do this, we can do that, and yes, let's do that. But the degree of change that we're going through is so massive for us in each of the units that we need to keep repeating to ourselves that we need to tone it down, we need to just start with the basics, start to crawl and then start to walk and then expand. And we need to repeat this very often to ourselves, because we can see already now in our colleagues from sales, from other departments want to embark, and they want this and they want that because they see these possibilities. We need to go through these gradual changes and improvements, and then we need to tweak. And we need to speak to others. I mean, that's, like I said, we are complete newbies. When I saw the Mazda presentation for us, this is science fiction / rocket science. We're completely unaware what's going on. We're so new to this, but I'm very certain that in a year from now we'll have a completely different level of understanding. But we are here to be able to speak to you, and if you, because of this presentation, have any opinion, if you've been on that journey, if you have a similar situation, if you've had, please come to us and tell us, do that, don't do this, you're stupid, whatever. Just please do reach out either today or at the bar. And that'd be it. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I don't know, do we do it now or at the bar?